Austria is as part of a European tour which I have to make between now and Christmas. I've got 3 months in which to record, if I possibly can, as many different craftsmen, hand workers, as I can in Holland and in Germany and in Austria and in Switzerland and in France and maybe in Spain if it gets very cold.
My name is Kevin Matthews. I'm a teacher and I live in Kirkburton in Yorkshire. My teacher's salary pays my living, but I'm also quite widely recognised as a craftsman, as a clog maker. The kind of clogs I make are the traditional style of Yorkshire clogs, which fasten with a clasp, using the hand-stitching methods as used for perhaps 100 years. For about the last 20 years, I've demonstrated the skills of clog making at events all over England. In February in 1991, I outlined my ideas for a study tour of Europe in which I would travel from town to town through France and Germany, making and demonstrating my clogs, and at the same time finding and filming other traditional crafts in those areas I passed through. Thanks to the generosity of the Goldsmith's Company of London, who considered this project to be worthy of a travel grant, I was able to study and record these old crafts.
It's 10 o'clock in the morning. I've spoken to a tourist information place and they've given me one or two campsites and places I can go to visit, and one of them is a glassblower's. I'm hoping to visit that tomorrow. This is the vehicle which I bought to travel in. It's a Volkswagen LT31 van, which is converted into a camper. It's very pleasant, it's very nice. I have my bicycle attached to the back, and I have all the clog tools inside the roof at the front. I'm traveling alone. I have no fixed dates. I have no fixed places that I have to go to. I'm completely free to choose, to travel, to stop, to demonstrate and to film. I don't know what's going to happen. It's quite frightening, quite interesting.
My first destination in Holland from Rotterdam was the little town of Leerdam. As well as being famous for cheesemaking, Leerdam has for many centuries been famous for glassmaking. The expert glassmakers are those who can make unicos. That is a piece which is absolutely unique. There isn't another one the same. And one of the most outstanding world famous unico glassmakers or sculptors is a man called Willem Heesen. Now I met, not Willem at first, but his son Bernard, and was invited into his glass workshop. where I saw many of the pieces which had been completed, and I asked if it was in order for me to come and visit and to film inside his workshop. The public are not allowed in his workshop because it's quite dangerous. However, he did agree for me to film. Now, my film shows three generations of craftsmen: Willem, the old master; Bernard, that's his son, who is younger and stronger and capable of lifting a very large mass of molten glass and working all day with it; and a young trainee or apprentice who's come from Kenya. He's called Anselm, and he's learning the skills in this workshop. All three of them at some stage are involved in making one piece, and at a particular point where the piece goes wrong or they spot some errors in it, all three of them come together to make a joint decision as to continue. It is pretty certain, therefore, that this workshop will carry on the tradition of producing world-class unico sculptures into the future.
What happens if you get it wrong? If you don't reheat correctly?
Well, if the glass cools down for too long, then it'll crack, break off the
glass. All right. Is it a good medium to work with glass?
It's an exciting medium to work with.
Yes, I'm sure it is. One of the pleasures and surprises of a journey like this is that you see things unexpectedly as you go along. Whilst travelling along the road between Leerdam and Ramsdonksveer, I spied a thatcher at work on the roof of a single-storey building. I decided to do a U-turn, came back, and met this young man and asked him some questions about the life of a thatcher.
This gentleman, Bert, has agreed to show me that the material here
was in the winter we cut it off.
In the winter you cut it, yes?
Yes. And it's
it's fastened.
Yes.
Yeah. Always with this natural material.
Yes.
In England we call this withies.
Yeah. This is tenge.
Ah, right. Tenke.
It's good. Yeah.
Yes.
Well, it's short.
Yes, it's quite a short one, yes. And this is a long one.
Yeah.
What is the name for this piece?
Ein Bosfried.
You say this is a small job.
Yeah.
How many days will it take you to finish this job?
About 8-9 days.
Ah, is that all? That's very good. That's quick.
Yes.
And for how many years will it last before you have to make a new one?
About 50, 60 years.
50, 60 years? Yes. That's terrific. That's tremendous. I'm really impressed. Have you been doing this for very long?
18 years.
18 years. Since you left school, perhaps?
Yes.
Yes. Did you become a thatcher because your father was a thatcher, or you knew somebody, or you just wanted to be a thatcher?
I knew somebody.
You knew somebody,
yes.
If you had a son who was 16, could he begin to follow you and be a thatcher?
It's possible.
Yes, he could. It's not an unusual.
No.
What is the most difficult part of the thatcher's job? You don't know. From Leerdam and the thatcher of Ramsdonk, I drove to the little town of Best, where I was told that I would find the centre of Dutch clog making. The traditional old wooden clog, or klompen, is still made here in several small factories, of which the most famous is the Klompen Museum de Platijn, owned by the family van Laarhoven. Here I met Wim van Laarhoven, who made me welcome, allowed me to park overnight in his little field,
and showed me how the traditional Dutch clog is made by the old hand methods.
Now this is the traditional first stage. You begin with a block.
Yes.
We begin with the block.
Yeah. And after that I put that knife. But this is to begin.
This is just the very start. Yeah. So, can I ask you, Wim, what is the kind of wood you're using
the
here?
The kind of poplar.
A poplar?
Poplar and willow. We have two kinds of wood.
Yes?
The poplar and the willow.
Of course, in Holland you must have all the wood that grows next to a stream.
Yes. And after that, he take that knife, I can do it.
Yes.
Yeah. And he make the outside shape from the wooden shoe. And he did it with this knife.
Ah. You always cut from the center to the end, to the outside.
The outside, yeah.
Yeah. It's a very nice, clean wood to cut. It's a very... It seems quite a soft wood.
And so we make the old outside
shape.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
And you must make a left and a right, of course.
Yes, you must make a left and a right. And this is what one man did in one day by machine, and one day by hand.
Ah, there's
that
a comparison.
That is by machine, and that is handwork.
I do it by hand, but...
You do it by hand?
Yes. Another clogmaker does it by machine.
Oh, you do it by hand?
Yes, we do it...
That is handwork.
And it's Wim has very kindly agreed to demonstrate on this big copying lathe how the scooping of the interior is done. Just place two blanks. There's a thing in the middle, which is the tool which I believe follows the interior. And then the outside is cut by two of the cutters.
65% of this shoe is water.
Yes.
And sometime I can make the water out of the shoe.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, look at that! That's amazing!
Moment a bit, yeah, sometimes it is possible, right?
Wim is actually blowing the water out of the shoe. Let's look at this closely. That's extraordinary!
Then we bring him to a drying room.
Yes, ah!
Yeah, then he get for 4 or 5 days in a drying room.
Slowly?
Yeah, very slowly.
Because if you dry a clog quickly, it might crack.
Yeah, and then we have that.
Yes.
Because when you have this one or that one,
the other ones are still quite heavy.
And when you look in the shop, you can see the red color, the yellow.
Yes.
Yes, all kind of colors.
Now, I prefer personally, myself, to have a wooden clog looking like wood.
Oh.
I suppose about 5 or 6.
Do you do it all by hand, not by machine?
Oh, no, we don't do no machine at all.
Oh, no machine.
In my workshop, I'm just one man.
En doet gelijk met de hand.
This man is a star. I really like him. I enjoyed filming and I enjoyed talking to him. And he liked the Yorkshire clogs which I made. In fact, he liked them so much that he asked me to demonstrate how I made them in his workshop. And finally, he bought a pair for his display. And then, of course, having sold my clogs in Holland, I felt like the rest of my tour could be downhill from there.
And so, on behalf of my workshop, please accept.
Thank you very much.
This pair of clogs.
Thank you
for your collection to go in here.
Okay.
Passing through Venlo into Germany, I'd heard that there was to be a Herbstfest, a kind of country fair, in the Nordrhein-Westphalian town of Siegen. The main street of the town, the Marburger Strasse, is closed off for the main event, a demonstration of traditional country skills by the handarbeiters or craftsmen of Munsterland. I introduced myself to the Lady Mayor, the Burgermeister of Siegen, and asked if she would like to have a Yorkshire clogmaker to demonstrate at this event. She promptly ordered the organisers to find me a prime site and set up my bench.
I was kindly invited by the mayor to stay here and to demonstrate English clogs. This is a tradition from Yorkshire. So far today, I've cut out a large piece of leather and made two pieces like this, then stitched it on here. Then from then, I took this form, which is we call fuss form. This is fuss form. And what is this called? The Zola, Fussform, Leder, and then here is the clog when it's finished. Here we have a long stick. This is a bent. It's very tight. And out it comes. So, this looks still very like the area where the and off we go again. And off this one to it.
questioning the mayor and various craftsmen I met in Siegen, I learned of a master blacksmith, Herr George Lauber, who ran his forge in the mountain village of Lützel. He's brilliant, they said. Go and see him.
So I went. As I parked my camper outside his forge, I was immediately impressed by the building. Now here was a business with a future. The young striker we see working in the forge is Herr Lauber's son.
Was machen Sie?
Zeigerfleisch.
Ah, ja.
Zeigerfleisch.
I did ask and you did tell me. I'm interested to see that Mr. Lauber uses the proper method of collars across, that the joints are not welded as so many so-called blacksmiths do these days. I have a brother-in-law who's a blacksmith, and many years ago he did point out to me the finer points. In traditional artwork from the blacksmith, it was never a part of the work to use oxyacetylene welding or electric welding. And so the joints were made with straps or collars. And if we look closely at the piece which is on the anvil, on the table of the anvil at the moment, oh, that's beautiful, it matches perfectly. We can see that we have the upper and lower straight piece strapped together with two bent pieces, which are a nice open shape. This is a very beautiful gate.
Und das wird also praktisch im Feuer, im teichigen Zustand,
ja,
wird das zusammengeschlagen.
Ah. So, all the pieces are going to go together and they're going to be hammered together. And I'm very interested in that. Bit of delicate precision there. As the iron becomes thinner, it's important not to allow the job to become too hot, because it can burn away. And particularly when, as in this case, the end has been split into two, it's not impossible to just overlook it for a second or two longer in the fire and have one of the parts burn away. I happen to know this because I've done it myself. And it's only by making such errors that you begin to realise how important it is to keep not only the heat correct, but also the time. As all good anvils are set in a wooden tree stump, so it's... drawn it out into a long square point. Ah, I see what it is now. It's a beautifully shaped leaf. What a beautiful leaf with those diagonals. I think my brother-in-law is very interested in seeing this piece of film. So it goes in the barrel and it's cooling off down there. Not so much cooling, huh?
It needs for this a special temperature.
Ah.
Germany, together with the west part of Germany.
That's brilliant. It had been made in two pieces, this piece of sculpture, and it's in Edelstahl, it's in sort of stainless steel. and then it's now welded together. That's symbolic.
Oktoberfest. I was amazed to find this strange Bavarian cultural event taking place exactly as I passed through Munich, heading south to Austria.
Last night, and it's just after midday.
I've travelled down this motorway here, and I'm somewhere between Munich and Garmisch-Partenkirchen, which is here. I hope to make that by tonight, and then perhaps go and have a look at a place called Mittenwald.
Set high in the Bavarian Alps is this famous little tourist centre. There were many visitors when I arrived. In fact, I felt I was the only one not wearing red socks and boots. Located as it is on the old trading route to Italy, Mittenwald became important first as a trading centre. Later, Bolzano took prominence as the trading centre on this route, and of course it left the citizens of Mittenwald with the need of a new livelihood. And this is how violin making became established here. The first violin maker was a man called Herr Klotz, and he'd learned his skills of violin making in Italy. And he came here and set up his workshop, and there are now 7 or 8 violin makers who carry on the tradition in the town, the most famous of which is Herr Moller. I met Herr Moller in his workshop, and also his beautiful young assistant, Angelica.
She was telling me a few minutes ago that she had 3.5 years training in school in violin making, and now she has worked here for 2.5 years. Angelica has explained that it takes something between 60 hours and 100 hours to make a violin. Ich verstehe, ja.
Es ist schwierig.
Es ist schwierig.
Das dauert lange, dann müssen Sie den ganzen Tag filmen oder so.
Okay. It's very difficult to explain exactly how it's made in a short film in 10 minutes. But now we're looking at some precision fitting.
Es wird die Steg, du musst genau drauf, gerade aufliegen.
Ah, so. Und das ist important.
Ist wichtig, ja.
Ja. Mhm.
Mhm. Wichtig für den Ton, für den Sound.
Der Ton.
Right.
Was ist das?
Das da?
Ja.
Der Zicklinge.
Der Zicklinge. As well as all the violins, we can also see here cellos. And above me I can see a rack of guitars. And over here, the bows, violin, that's the shop through which I came. And all these violins here are either in for repair or they've perhaps been made here. So here it is. And in the window we can see examples of the pieces for a violin, stopped at the various stages of production. So that we can see the blank. Then we can see the panels for the side. I don't know the technical name for these. And apparently it isn't so easy to explain. Over there we can see a former around which the violin is built. And here on this scraper bench is the back of a violin being prepared. So, viel Arbeit for Geigermacher. These are all repairs. You can see that something unfortunate has happened to this cello here, and it's been clamped up and glued up. Vielen Dank for mein Video.
Having carefully checked my oil and water, I drove up and over the High Alps until I came to the Austrian town of Innsbruck in search of new skills. Of all the towns I visited, I have to say that I found Innsbruck to be the most impressive. I had planned to film and to stay for one night. In fact, I stayed for 4 days. I made friends, I cycled, climbed the mountains, and met a young lady called Daniela, a pavement jeweller. Now, she explained to me some of the practical problems of making and selling handcraft jewellery in the EEC in 1991. Although theoretically we are a free market now, in practice she finds that the high street retailers, who by the way don't always make things themselves, don't like the competition, and she and other small traders are asked to move on by the police. Now, she is not a retailer. Every item she sells is absolutely uniquely handmade, there and then, on the spot. I feel very strongly that the EEC politicians, who have their vision of European free trade, should be the first to acknowledge the contrast between genuine small manufacturers like Daniela and those big city retailers who make nothing actually themselves, but who flood the tourist market with trinkets, often imported at low cost from Far East countries.
Innsbruck is a town of many hand workers, and one of them here is Sandra. She is a jeweller in costume jewellery and sculpture, and she's working at a jeweller's bench here. I recognise the clamp and the very fine jeweller's saw, which is used for cutting out shapes. At the moment she's filing away a sharp edge. Das ist schön. Das ist ein Angle. Angle?
Angle, ja.
Angle. Ah, good. Oh, it's beautiful. Und lernen Sie diese Arbeit in Schule? Ja.
Nein, das mache ich in der Werkstatt.
Ah, in der Werkstatt?
Ja.
Und vor wie viele Jahren?
3 Jahre.
3 Jahre?
Ja.
Now, I'm in the underground workshop of Mario. Mario is repairing a 100-year-old clock. Mario, was ist das Problem hier?
Die Zeigerpin.
Ah, it's broken. Das ist kaputt.
Yes.
Oh, so. So this is a clock which is made to go inside a tower. It drives a large face outside. Any young boys who want to find some skills can do so by studying clockmaking here. What a lot of hairpin bends. Wow, it just goes round and round and round.
I left Innsbruck and drove through Austria and Switzerland and into France. My conversations with the young apprentices in Innsbruck had given me much to think about. Clearly, there is a future for young people who can use their hands and their brains to make their living, but it's harder for some than it is for others. If your father is an established craftsman, obviously you're off to a good start. If you're employed as a trainee, you can have warmth and shelter and a wage to keep you going as you learn. But if, like Daniela, you're starting from nothing, then you have to struggle to get started. I went through all sorts of hills and twisty roads and double bends until I came past Besançon and into France and to a village south of Loire called Villain les Rochers, and here I met Christophe.
This village is famous throughout France as being the centre of basket making. Que faites-vous exactement, Christophe, maintenant?
Un panier pour mettre le linge.
Ah, cool. Et c'est léger, ça dure longtemps?
Oui, très longtemps.
Ah bon.
C'est léger.
Oui.
Solide.
Oui.
Et durable, ça dure longtemps.
So it's going to be a laundry basket. It's going to be quite a tall one, I believe. And it's very light, and they last a long time. Vous avez décidé avant, peut-être au collège, d'être vanier?
Oui.
Ah bon? Pourquoi?
Pour faire un métier manuel.
Ah oui, oui.
Et puis vivre à la campagne.
Ah bon? Et c'est difficile ou non?
Comme métier? Oui, c'est assez dur.
Ah oui.
Les outils, c'est ça, une batte.
Une batte, oui.
Un poinçon,
oui.
Un sécateur.
Sécateur, naturellement.
Serpette.
Oui. Ah oui.
Un mètre.
Oui.
Un crayon,
et ça c'est tout, et les choses les plus importantes.
Et des mains.
Des mains.
Tout à fait.
Des mains d'un artiste, ah bon.
Ouais. Et puis un œil aussi.
Oui.
Important l'œil.
That's extraordinary that here in this town that's famous for its basket making, there are actually some English basket makers. Basket maker and his wife came and had a look at my clogs. Et on peut marcher? Ah bon?
Non, mais il faut pas que ce soit trop serré parce que j'ai de la place dedans. Hein.
Ah oui.
Dedans, il y a
oui,
de la place.
Oui, bon.
Mais il faut pas que ce soit serré des sabots, c'est pas des chaussures, quoi.
If you wonder how many different products can be made using basket work, just look at these. Seems almost incredible, everywhere the eye looks, every single thing is made from willow and osiers, even a wardrobe over there. I'm standing in a farmyard near to La Fleche. I'm with my friend Monsieur Mem, who's very kindly brought me to this farm to see something of interest. Okay, Monsieur. This is very exciting, and across a plank bridge. I'm going to try and film this at the same time as walking over it. It could be quite interesting. We've arrived here at this interesting wooden building. What we're seeing here is a still, and people bring their cider here. And it is cooked in this enormous bain-marie made of copper, the fire underneath it, and then it goes up into the header tank. It evaporates, of course, and is condensed by cold water. So it has two trips round. So it's got different clients who bring different amounts of cider in here. It can be cider of not just apples, but also pears. Est-ce qu'il existe une différence avec les pêches? Pour cidre de pêche.
C'est pas du cidre de pêche. Le non, cidre, c'est... le terme est réservé pour le ce qui est obtenu à partir des pommes.
Ah oui.
Par contre, les pêches.
C'est un autre liquide.
Bah voilà, on met les pêches à macérer dans un fût.
Oui.
Les
oui.
prunes aussi.
Oui.
Alors on y ajoute quelquefois du cidre.
Pour du sucre.
Du sucre.
Oui.
Et donc, ça, on fait macérer, ça donne un liquide qu'on oui. distille à nouveau pour obtenir de l'eau de vie de pêche,
ah,
ou
oui.
de l'eau de vie de prune, ou de l'eau de vie de
bois. Juste un autre goût.
Il fumait maintenant que je ne peux en faire. Je faisais du mal de raisin.
Ah oui.
Après avoir tiré le jus de raisin,
oui.
on mettait le mal dans une barrique et bien tassé.
C'est ce que c'est que le mal, Kevin.
Oui.
Le mal, c'est quand on a pressé. La vigne.
Oui, c'est...
Bon, il reste la rafle
Oui.
Et tout ce qui reste, les pépins, etc., il reste une espèce de résidu.
Oui, résidu.
Voilà. Oui, et avec ce résidu, on arrive encore à faire de l'eau de vie qu'on appelle du marc.
Du marc. This is the final proof of this high-powered liquid. I don't know. I'm not quite sure what to make of this. Merci bien et à votre santé, monsieur. Oh, et quel...
Ça va, hein?
Comme c'est fort, hein? Oh, il est fort. Oh, that is a fantastic taste. I have never tasted anything quite as powerful as that. Ça, c'est eau de vie.
Oui.
Oh, ça chauffe, c'est bien. Hein? Je continue.
J'ai une guichette dans avec de la terre, alors j'allais y crever dessus. Je les ai corrigés avec un âge mouillé sur les yeux, sur la bouche.
Ah, oui.
Il y en a un, il s'appelle Colo.
I've stopped in the middle of the village and I'm parked in front of the workshop of Monsieur Maurice Cosnier. Monsieur Cosnier is a tonnelier and his workshop is a tonnellerie. It's at the end of a garden. We're going to go through and have a look at it now. De la crosse des. Ah, voilà.
Moi, j'ai un plan coudé pour me mettre à tracer.
Ah oui. Ça, c'est combien de lits?
220 litres.
220 litres. It's a 220 litre barrel, this one.
Bon. Alors,
il faut être absolument exact.
Ah oui, oui, oui. Avec mes doigts de graisse. Alors, là, voyez.
Now, having got them exactly to size, they've got to be placed in this this ring in a certain order. Comme ça, oui.
Comme ça.
Oui. Comme ça.
Là.
Voilà.
Et ainsi de suite, quoi. Oh.
Ça demande combien pour un tonneau comme ça?
Pour le faire?
Oui.
En fin de journée, hein. Voyez-vous, bon.
Voilà. Ah oui, mais... Ça demande combien de morceaux? Oui.
De morceaux? Oh, 27 à 28 morceaux comme ça.
28 of those.
Pour la barrique de 220 litres?
Oui.
Hein, je parle le mien.
It very slightly, it depends on the size.
Voyez-vous?
And
là, j'ai trouvé une variété parce que j'en ai plus.
Oui.
J'ai préparé, voyez-vous?
The diameter has to be a little bit bigger on one side than the other. It isn't just flat. It's cranked round here.
Voilà.
Gives it... A curve, but it also gives it a different diameter. Now it goes on to the...
Plus long.
Ah oui, c'est un peu plus long, oui. And now we're going to see the riveting. Oh, I'll try another one. On this little anvil. This nut is used to drive them down.
C'est un cercle pour tenir les doigts, là, voyez-vous.
Oui. On n'a pas de nom spécifique pour ça.
Bon, après.
Ah oui.
On la met en place. Et là, on tâche.
Voilà. Ça, c'est pour mettre...
Là, c'est pour faire le chanfrein. Et oui. Ça servait autrefois pour faire la rainure.
Ah oui.
Je sais pas si
ça fait la ligne. Exact.
pour recevoir le fond.
So we get an exact line there. Oh yes, it's cutting quite well. Ah,
voilà,
a spigot.
Entre ici, au fond.
Oui, oui.
Pour mettre la canal.
And that's where the spigot goes in the tap. Ah, c'est fait tous en bois.
Ça, c'est une canal en bois. Elle est en acacia.
Ah, bon. Je n'ai jamais vu un...
Ah, putain, vous pouvez voir. Avec un liège ici.
Oui.
Et c'est fait en acacia.
Et on fait ça ici ou...
Alors, les petites sont faites en buis.
Et merci, monsieur. C'est ça?
Merci,
c'est correct?
Monsieur. Voilà, merci, monsieur.
Et merci. Ça, c'est pour mes deux bouteilles de rhum.
Ah, oui.
I'm just about to go into the little workshop of Monsieur Chaussy. There he is, working away at his bench. Bonjour! On de rencontrer ici, après combien des années? C'est peut-être 10 ou 12 ans? 12 ans?
Une dizaine d'années, oui.
Une dizaine d'années! Nous sommes un peu plus âgés. Et toujours les sabots. At this moment, the inside is being carved out, and this is a very interesting process. It uses these long T-shaped scoops, lots of leverage from the side. It's just been explained. Well, that's the cross cut, which is lowering the floor of the clog. Force involved here, a lot of power. The wood is still slightly wet because, of course, it's easier to work like that. It's clamped in this vise, which is a sort of huge block of wood with wedges that go in from the side. Shavings everywhere. Now we've looked at some clogs here that are extremely interesting. I'm going to turn one of these over. Do they look like an ordinary pair of clogs? Yes, they do. We turn them over and we find something that's very, very strange. Look at this. Now then, I'm turning it, and you'll remember that this here is the back of the clog. The other end is the front of the clog. Look at it again. That's it. And the heel is at the toe end. Et ça, c'est nommé quoi?
Sabot de braconnier.
C'est le sabot de braconnier. In other words, it's the traditional footwear of those who go hunting when they're not supposed to at night. And if you think about it, it's to put people off the trail. If they find a footprint, they'll find a footprint, but it'll be going in the wrong direction. Isn't that amazing? I've never seen anything like that before.
Ouais, on considérait plutôt comme un attardé, quoi.
Un attardé, oui, oui. c'est pareil en anglais. Je suis retardé parce que je suis saboté.
Ce n'est pas moi qui ai changé, ce sont...
Non, c'est la société.
La société qui a changé.
La société a changé, mais c'est bon, hein, à ce moment. Ah, oui. Apparently there's still one factory in France that still orders 50 or 60 pairs every year of clogs for its employees because they're the only footwear they can wear. They're on hot glass. They're moving around and... Ordinary safety boots and footwear just won't stand for it. They burn away. So, just as in some places in England, I've seen them used in British Steel, for example, up at Teesside, where on the rolling mill, the sheet mill, as the black hot steel comes off, somebody has to quickly mark up every batch, because if they leave it until it's gone out into the yard, it rusts and various other problems. So they mark it straight away, and these chaps walk about on clogs, industrial clogs, which have steel steel shoes underneath like a horseshoe. About 20 years ago you were considered to be an idiot if you still worked at this sort of métier. But now people ask him to sign the clogs though he was an artist, and he says he isn't an artist, he's a craftsman. And that's what he wants to do. He wants to be a craftsman, not an artist. But certainly not someone who's considered retarded just because he uses his hands. Perhaps the time will come in England when we too again appreciate the skills of a man like this. I think it'll come. Everybody can't work with computers. Everybody can't have a Porsche and a telephone in the car. The time will come when this will be appreciated once again. And with a bit of luck, I'll have a film about it.
I left my fellow craftsmen in France and returned to England in time for Christmas. The clogmaker Jean-Marc Chaussy had given me encouraging news on the state of European crafts. His business is on the increase, and French society has once again begun to value traditional skills such as his. We must ask, is it too late for some craftsmen? Is it too late in England for us all to recognise the value of our traditional skills and to preserve and encourage them for our next generation? My son made his first pair of clogs at the age of 9.